Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported by a friend of BCTV.
Greetings and welcome to another edition of Berks Perspectives. I'm Chuck Gallagher, and having weathered the storm that really wasn't that much of a storm, we have a trio of dynamic personalities with us today. Fred Levering to my left.
Hi, Chuck.
Ruth Martelli to his left.
Hi, Chuck.
And to her left, Fred Opalinski.
Missing the snow.
Missing the snow?
I was all set to shovel.
Oh, before
you
we get on that.
Enough in here.
Yeah, exactly. Before we get too far into it, I wanted to say that this is going to be marking the end of the reign of Mr. Harry Dietz at the Reading Eagle. As the editor, Harry's going to be retiring as of tomorrow, I believe, on the 9th.
Was he your successor?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, he was. He was. Harry and I go way back. He was when he was covering wrestling and sports, and I was covering cops. We'd go out and play a little golf together. Both of us were equally bad at the game.
But he's served the community very well.
He has indeed. Yeah. But Harry is the kind of person that when he would leave for work, his desk would be clear. When I would
one
leave,
of those.
Yeah, when I would leave work, my desk looked like it had been slept in and beaten. But
I used to have a sign on my desk that said a clean desk is a sign of a sick mind.
Yes, thank you. I wish I'd known that. I could have used it. Anyway. So long, Harry. Have a good retirement and enjoy.
I'm sure we're going to still be hearing from him.
Oh, I'm sure we will. I'm sure. We'll take a look at the city council now. City council is beginning to take a look at the housing stock. They're looking at neighborhoods. They're trying to find ways to get out of Act 47. I think it's nice to see that they're beginning to move in these directions. Some activity from council.
I think they're making progress. It's been a long uphill battle, but they seem to be, you know, the key is not getting out of 47 as quick as possible, it's staying out.
Staying out, right.
And, you know, I just hope they don't do anything prematurely just in order to get out. You know, I mean, it's got to be right.
Well, I think what they're looking at with neighborhoods, too, as opposed to rehabbing a house in a neighborhood, do an entire neighborhood at one time as much as you possibly can, seems to me make a lot more sense.
Habitat for Humanity has been trying to work
right.
with that in mind. I mean, they did a row of houses on Elm Street, and because there's more of a chance that that's going to have an effect on the on a larger portion of the neighborhood than just a hit and miss here and there.
I was also pleased to see that they're going to be resurfacing Perkiomen Avenue, which is very much like a war zone almost in terms of driving.
And that's all part of the enhancements the state's able to make on infrastructure, where they're going to be going from Perkiomen Avenue in Reading all the way down to basically where it blends into the end of the West Shore Bypass.
Oh, that far?
So it's going to be a long project. They're going to be doing sidewalks and curbs in some areas as well as the road. It's going to really be a nice improvement. Long overdue.
Well, they had the same thing over on the 18th Ward, where they did Pershing Boulevard.
Mm-hmm. And Kenner's Boulevard.
And Kenner's, that was way overdue. Also in the city, the managing director, Glenn Steckman, seems to be dealing with a lot of balls at the same time because there's some vacancies in the city jobs, and he's been filling in there, and that's a shame to do that to anybody, and it keeps the ball moving, but not very fast. You know, kicking the can down the road, I think only one man can kick so many cans at one time.
That's how you burn people out and have them
yeah,
resign.
Exactly.
Or make mistakes and they have to quit, which is too bad. But I think staffing at the city has been a problem for a long, long time. And I think that's also one of the reasons we've had some of the problems and some of the scandals we have with mishandled monies and what have you.
That's but an administration point. Has to lead by example also, though. And I mean, we've had cutbacks in the police department, and I've always thought of public safety, police and fire, as the most important functions of any government. So if there's cutbacks there, then the administration has to tighten its belt as well. And
which it pretty much did, I think.
But I think it's time to start filling in some of those spots. And
again, that's with Act 47, here you are, you're trying to fill those spots, but at the same time, you're supposed to be having a positive approach financially.
Filling those spots requires spending more money, and that's going to be a negative as far as the budget.
But we did both say last week, because I remember there was a shockwave because we agreed on it, that you don't want to be premature with getting out of Act 46.
Right.
You want to know that you're firmly on the road to recovery, if not recovered, before you make that leap out of 47, because there are advantages to being in it.
Recovery is a lead into the next thing I wanted to take a look at. The mental health facility in Bern Township seems to be moving along in terms of being accepted by the township. Now I guess they have to go to the different zoning areas to find out if it's
applicable. It's a multi-step process, and there's still approvals from the Planning Commission and then back to the supervisors again. It looks as though that it will likely happen from everything I've been reading. There's still concerns on the part of some of the residents, not too awfully far away, but also not exactly next door in Greenfield.
Right.
It's understandable. I mean, you got a family and kids and all the rest, and you worry about some of the stuff that goes on in your general vicinity. But this is a facility that we really need, and I think when we see all the, not all, but many of the problems across the country today with shootings and everything else, one of the common denominators seems to be some mental health issues, and so it's something we got to have.
Spruce Pavilion has been at Reading Hospital for a long, long time, right in the middle of West Reading neighborhood,
right.
And I'm not aware of issues related to that presence. So,
and like many other things, mental illness is a continuum, and there are some aspects of mental illness that are hardly cause for concern. Panic attacks, anxiety, depression, those things are all fairly mild examples of mental health issues. So to think automatically when you hear a mental health way over here where somebody is a, you know, an axe murderer is just not, it's not fair to people who have conditions that are hardly threatening.
Well said. We're taking a look now at, for your point, today is a special day for women, is it not?
Today is, yes.
International Women's Day, right?
International Women's Day?
Started by a German woman in 1910.
That long ago?
Yeah.
Really, 1910?
I believe
that's
so.
That's before suffrage. I think that women didn't get the vote until 1920, I believe.
Well, I could be wrong. I often am.
Well, it depends. I mean, women had the vote in other countries before we did in 1920. But
she said, I won't say anymore because I can't prove it. I don't have my phone.
Okay.
So you guys can check me out.
The phone will out.
Well, congratulations to you.
Yes. I am a woman.
Yes, and
hear
you're
me
international.
There are so many women who've done so many amazing things. And by and large, we don't really talk about them or know about them.
Well,
maybe it's appropriate that scientists believe they found the bones of Amelia Earhart, who was one heck of a terrific woman
pioneer.
Well,
they found the bones in 1940. It's just now that they've been able to analyze them to find out that they do, in fact, match her stature. And so that's...
I'm surprised they couldn't do some DNA. She surely has family members around.
I have no idea.
I don't think so. They've tried many number
of
ways.
Is that right? Okay. Yeah, because I... But 99 out of 100% seem to be, I mean, it's...
And again, staying with the women's theme, if we could, did you all watch the Oscars or segments of the Oscars? You didn't watch the Oscars?
I watched it until I fell asleep.
Okay.
I didn't watch it.
I missed the last ones.
I saw some of the, highlights, or whatever you want to call them, that are inevitable.
Well, Frances McDormand
was
her little speech. Come on, girls, everybody who won an award, stand up. Let them know we're out here. Let them know we have ideas. And let them know that they can spend money with us. And they can give us a call or even drop in on us. It was quite a little speech. And she carries a lot of schwack with her.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She's,
is that a big stick?
That's a real big stick. This is her second Academy Award.
Do you know what
Award.
I like about her? Her dress came up to here.
Yeah.
She really, you can tell she doesn't really believe in plastic surgery. Her hair is great.
Or makeup, or hairstylist.
Right.
Yes, right. Yes,
but go find a more terrific actress. When she had her role in Fargo, I mean, she's extraordinary.
Yeah.
And I will say, she went to my high school.
Did she really?
Her father was a Christian Christian church minister in Manesson, which is a little town that I grew up in south of Pittsburgh. And so that's why my wife stayed awake to watch it, and I fell asleep, and I felt so bad.
And isn't she married to one of the Cohen directing brothers?
I think he's A. Cohen or related to Cohen's, I think. I'm not sure.
No, C-O-E-N. One of those brothers is her spouse.
Okay. But she's wonderful in the Three Billboards, if you haven't seen it.
We have seen it.
You have seen that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the same character.
No.
Not hardly that. That's why she's quite versatile. And she also had Meryl Streep stand up and said, Meryl, if you're standing up, the others will stand up too. So Streep got up and did her thing.
Well, she was nominated for the post. Meryl Streep was.
Right.
On the other hand, another thing about the Oscars is that the ratings were dismal.
Yeah.
And I think it has to do with the same reason that the ratings for like the National Football League have declined, that people have had it up to here with everything being political. They want to go to the movies and then see who won and stuff like that. They want to go watch a football game to see who scores the most points. But this business that everything has to be viewed in context of some kind of a political observation is really getting old, I think, to a lot of people.
Well, it could be possibly. I don't know that the Oscars were all that much political, though there were some moments where people dropped the political comments, and they were
very unpolitical. It was not nearly as much as I thought. I mean, it was more about the women's issue, the Me Too stuff. There was hardly a mention of things in presidential.
Kimmel threw a couple one-liners in, but it was nothing really. I think people just maybe haven't seen these films, or they're just watching too much. Television has expanded incredible.
Really good quality TV. Well, and somebody said, you know, a fish, we're voting for a fish falling in love with a human.
Having a physical relationship with a human.
I think a lot of people didn't particularly like that film. I haven't seen it, so I
did
can't
see
say
it,
much.
And I was underwhelmed by it. Yeah. I was surprised that it won the award. Wouldn't have been my choice, but.
But Darkest Hour is coming to the Goggle Works.
Yes,
I haven't
surprising.
Seen that.
That's a great film.
It's great.
Oldham's characterization is tremendous.
I'll tell you what, I was thrilled that I can't remember his name, but have you seen Get Out?
No.
Did you see it? Well, it is a phenomenal film. A black director, I think it's one of the first times a black director has been nominated for Best Director of a Film. But if you haven't seen it, watch it on demand or rent it or something. Mm. It's funny.
I've heard people who found it totally disinteresting and left.
Oh, no, it was wonderful.
Yeah.
I loved it.
My grandson took me and my wife to see Star Wars.
Oh, okay. My son took me to see it.
So. It was easier to follow than you thought, right?
Right.
I had no
it
problem
was
at
for
all.
Me, yes.
More my speed.
Yeah. Quickly, teacher strike in West Virginia went on for what, 9 days, I believe? That was a question. They wanted 5%. They finally got their 5%. But that's the entire state was shut down, the education system.
I was interested to see the map in this morning's Reading Eagle, which showed I was going to say disparity. I guess it is disparity among teacher salaries across the country. Mm-hmm. And we're talking $30,000 difference between the states.
Well, and
Pennsylvania being one of the highest, West Virginia being one of the lowest.
And sadly, in California, where the salaries are decent, I would think, teachers can no longer afford to live in the communities where they teach.
The cost of living is out of this world.
And so now it's becoming common in teacher contracts to include, I think they've taken old buildings and converted them into like studio apartments or one bedroom apartments where teachers can rent a place to
spend the week. Oh my.
Yeah, because it's just become.
I know my daughter-in-law teaches in Virginia, and she said they get a huge influx of first year teachers coming from Pennsylvania, but after they've got a couple years in, they want to go back because Pennsylvania pays better than Virginia.
One of the states I read was proposing that instead of increasing salaries, they were going to eliminate the teachers needing to pay their state income tax, which strikes me as a bad idea, that it's not equal protection under the law and all
certainly
that.
Isn't.
I mean, it doesn't seem like a good idea to me, but They're literally looking under rocks to find the money.
But if you think about, well, maybe I'm dreaming, but when I was in school as a kid, you never would think of shouting out at a teacher or threatening a teacher. Well, that's not true. I had a fifth grade teacher who wrestled one of her students to the ground because he was a bully. But for the most part, being a teacher didn't leave you open to the kinds of criticism that people lob now. Letters to the editor sometimes say the most horrendous things about teachers. And honestly, people, we're trying to teach the next generation and inform them and make them, to the best of our ability, good citizens. And for the most part, people don't think we work long enough or we don't work hard enough. And I defy anybody, if you don't believe that a teacher earns his or her salary, call the school district and ask if you may sub for a day and take care of 24 kindergarten kids and tell me about your experience at the end of the day.
24 would be an ideal class size.
You bet.
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind teaching is one of the most difficult professions out there.
Speaking of economics.
But I think that there is public perception, right or wrong, that it's gotten out of control, and it's, I don't think so much to do with earnings of salary as much as it is the benefits stuff. And there was a point in time when teachers were really underpaid, and they made it up by having fairly attractive pensions and whatnot as benefits, but the salaries have caught up and the benefits just spiral out of control. And the average person doesn't have anything
you're
like that.
Talking about.
I don't
about
think they're begrudging the salary. I think that they're having a problem with the benefits.
No, I think that's your bugaboo. I mean, that's what we
it
always
is,
come
yes.
back to. But when you're talking about the people, and West Virginia is not the least paid.
It's 48th.
It's 48th. So there are two states who are even worse off.
Mississippi is, I think, at the bottom, maybe.
But what is a good salary?
I'm not arguing the salary. I think that the public's perception is that it's the benefits.
I think their perception is predicated on the fact that their taxes are going up at the same time teacher salaries are going up. They link the two together, and as they should, because the more you're paying in taxes, theoretically, are helping the education. So when you're getting an increase of 2%, 3% in taxes, teachers are getting a 4% and 5%, that begins, you're saying, hey, where am I going? And when does it stop?
It's because state and federal governments have not kept up with the increases, and so the burden has been on
communities. No, but then, and the medical expenses, for example, have gone through the roof, for cost-wise, and that's not the fault of the teachers, but it's a fault of the system, and there's some way you've got to, I don't know how you can find a balance.
I just, you know, on any given night, and I don't watch all that much TV, but on any given night during the hour of any given program, there must be 15 drugs that are advertised on TV.
Right.
Do you know, and if you can't advertise liquor, which you can't, why should you be allowed to peddle drugs?
You can't advertise liquor now.
Well, I don't see those ads as much as I see.
You can do beer. I don't think you can do liquor.
I don't think you can do
Yeah, there's some brandy ads on television.
Well, let me just say that the drug ads far outnumber those for most other things.
And television is thrilled to get the money.
With an opioid crisis devastating this state as well as vast parts of the country, doesn't anybody think it might be a good idea to take them off? Because
well, on this one, I agree with you because they're being advertised to the consumer,
who don't,
not to the doctor who's supposed to prescribe the thing.
And who's paying for it?
Yeah.
How they do that is, have you noticed that every one of these doggone maladies has a nickname? Oh, it's ABC or, you know, whatever. So you're supposed to go march into your doctor and say, you know, doctor, I think maybe I've got ABC.
And
shouldn't
so
I be taking
drug.
Something or another?
Yeah.
I mean, it's really wrong.
Yeah, don't give me the generic or don't give me the alternative.
Right.
Give me the stuff that I see on television.
I just heard, and I think this hospital is in Texas, where they've stopped using opioids for people who are in pain.
There was a study that I just saw a part of. I didn't read the entire article. I ran out of time, but I saw something yesterday. that indicated that there was some long-term study that found that they don't work, that the opioids don't work over the long haul.
After a while, the system...
That after a while, you seem to just block it out or whatever, and your craving for it apparently still goes on, you know. Yeah.
So this hospital is using analgesics, Tylenol, you know, the more hefty doses of Tylenol, and absolutely not prescribing painkillers. So to try to subvert some of the addiction that's going on, because that's one way that you can become addicted. But I watch those ads for every drug known to man, and I think, why are you allowed to do that?
Because they're developing all these cures because there's the demand for them, and they're making money off of it.
But when you listen to the side effects,
the doctors ought to be the ones deciding.
Exactly.
not getting. Person in front of the television.
Well, doctors don't know unless they try the drugs.
But how do you think?
But they don't need to see it on television.
How do you think those drug companies recoup the prices for their advertising?
That's what I said. Who's paying for it?
Yeah, by charging exorbitant amounts for medication. Stop that.
Do the Canadians allow that much advertising on television?
I don't live in Canada, so I don't
know. Well, I know, but I'm just wondering if Canada has the same kind of policy.
Call Justin Trudeau after the show and ask him.
All right. Do you have his number?
Yes, on speed dial. Thank you.
On speed dial. Indeed. Talking of economics, as I said, where we've seen that the president's economic advisor has stepped out of the picture because of the situation with the president wanting to impose tariffs on steel and aluminum. And I've been told that if that is the case and those tariffs go through, Europe is going to resoundingly come back at him by charging for peanut butter and cranberries. There'll be tariffs.
And bourbon.
And bourbon.
And anything we export.
But now Cohen, the gentleman in question, was very close to the president, evidently.
We're supposed to find out today at 3:30 maybe what he's got in mind, in fact. I mean, more specifically.
Well, there's apparently going to be a bunch of so-called carve-outs that certain nations or areas
Canada,
will not,
Mexico,
be,
yeah.
not be subject to the tariffs or whatever. And as far as Cohen's concerned, I think you got to respect both him, and I know you won't, but the president, from the standpoint that Trump campaigned on the idea of protecting American workers and talked about tariffs during the campaign. So he's honoring that. Cohen was definitely against them, and so they decided to part ways. Yeah. I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
I'm not suggesting there's anything wrong.
He may benefit 100,000 steel and aluminum workers,
but that
will be detrimental to millions of other people and perhaps even wipe out a lot of the tax benefits that came with this big tax package.
And I think people
are going to be paying more.
The problem with the policy is that it's one thing today. Yep, 25% on steel, 10% on aluminum, to everybody, everywhere, no carve-outs, no nothing. And then it's, well, maybe there'll be carve-outs. And then, I don't think they're going to... He seems incapable of saying what a policy is and then sticking to it.
But isn't that the nature of what he has spent his life doing, negotiating?
I don't care.
Start out here.
No.
It's no different than what Fred and I do every day with real estate.
Well,
I
mean, you aren't responsible for the millions and millions and millions of people who live in this country. And if you screw
but
up...
But leopards don't change their spots. How he has been a negotiator.
I'm sorry, Fred, but if you screw up a real estate deal, I'm not going to really suffer. But if he gets us in a trade war with the rest of the world, me and everybody in this room...
I think the consistency is an important part of presidential leadership or national leadership. And he is anything but consistent. So we'll see what happens.
If I may, I think possibly the man has a tendency of putting out an idea without really having done much homework to see about what it's going to establish. And he does that. He throws it out on the table, pretty much like throwing chum into the ocean, waiting for the sharks to come around and see who's going to bite and who's going to develop.
Well, and if you have, well, maybe Stephen Miller's in favor of this nationalistic policy, and Wilbur Ross and Navarro. Those are all older guys. And this policy of protectionism was popular 2-3 decades ago. But times have changed, boys and girls. And if you...
Well, that's why we've got a president like Mr. Trump.
It's a global economy.
Exactly. And if you think we can't function in a global economy, or if you think we can by taking these nationalistic positions, no.
Well, we're pulling away from a lot of the trade agreements, too.
His most ludicrous comment was that trade wars are easy to win.
Are easy to win.
And they're good for us. I mean, there's nobody that believes that.
I can't imagine that people are not cheerleading in the Kremlin, because the man is destroying our relationships with most of our, at least historic,
allies.
Yeah. And fawns all over these really despicable people, Putin being
one of them.
We'll
see what happens. I trust he's going to be, I shouldn't say that, I was going to say.
And Stormy, God knows what Stormy is going to do with...
Oh, Stormy's the whole thing with having sued the president. That's going to be interesting to see how that shakes out. Excuse me for using that.
And who's sleeping in the Capitol?
Some of the congressmen.
You bet they are.
They can't afford to. You're talking about affording everything, like what the teachers can't afford. Well, these guys, $176 a year seems $176,000 seems like a lot of money until you look at what you're going to pay for rent in D.C. and all your expenses. So a lot of these guys are just crashing in their rooms.
Having two residences, wherever you're from, as well as this.
But it
that was one of the reasons when I ran for Congress in the mid '90s. You can drive to D.C. and back in the same day if you had to. It's not fun, but you can do it. If you're a congressman from Wyoming, you're not going to do that. So you got to have two residences.
One of the things that suffers if you don't stay there and you never go out to dinner with your colleagues and you don't get to know people, you can have these huge divisions between parties and factions of parties, and they stay because there's never that chance to interact on a social level because you're sleeping in your office.
Well, we're not going to be sleeping here in the studio, fortunately.
Yes, I am.
We'd like to say goodbye. Thank you so much for watching us. And we'd also like to mention the passing of Roger Bannister, the first man to break the 4-minute mile, 88 years of age. Thank you for watching. Take care. Hope to see you next week.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported by a friend of BCTV.